Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I am your host, Jason Turner, available for code reviews and on-site training. In this episode, I'm going to talk about small object optimizations, as the title says, but before I get started, I do want to remind you that I do have this upcoming C++ Best Practices workshop at NDC Tech Town in Kongsberg, Norway, from September 9th to the 10th of 2024. Okay, so small object optimizations. These things exist in the standard library in string, any, function, at the very least. These are all things that might allocate, but also might have a way of reasonably avoiding allocation in some cases. Well, function and any pretty much kind of have to allocate. So does string. But the point being that we have ways of avoiding allocations with things called small object optimizations. And I'm going to give you a view of this. And just for the record, this is the first time I've ever implemented something like this myself. But I'm going to give you a view of it that I'm going to admit is a little bit simplified, but does work and does show how this kind of thing works. And avoid some, you know, hyper optimizations that you might be able to do in some particular cases. And for this example, I'm going to use a string-like thing. As C++ developers, we are honored to contribute to self-driving technology, simplify lives with embedded devices, support financial ecosystems, and assist traders with trading bots. To keep up with the pace of development, we need tools that help us work quickly and effectively. CLion is a powerful JetBrains IDE for C and C++ that makes this challenge its main goal, integrating code analysis, refactoring, and the best ecosystem tools into our day-to-day development. Use CPP Weekly CLion to get 25% off when you purchase a new CLion subscription or renew your existing one. Now, a string needs a few things. It needs a pointer to the data that has been allocated to the actual string object. And it needs the length of the allocated size, which can also be called capacity. So if these things, you know, are our private members, we might prefix them in some sort of fashion like this. Now, a string also needs the current size. And that's basically everything that you need to properly handle something like a string. Because string and vector can be over-provisioned, we can do something like a resize on them. So the capacity might be greater than the current length of data. This is also true if you had a long string and then shortened it to another string, the runtime isn't going to bother allocating and freeing more data just to try to shrink things. It's just going to reuse the allocated storage that it has. Okay, so one of these things must be known at all the time, but these two things represent things that we can kind of reuse their space for. And this is where that small object optimization comes into play. I know that I need a pointer if I have allocated things, and I need to know a length of that allocated storage if I have allocated things. So let's just wrap this up in a little bit of a little handy struct here and create an object of this type now as our member. Now let's say, is there some way for us to reuse that space in some scenarios? And we don't immediately know how big that is. I mean, I can glance at it and see that it is 16 bytes because it is the size of two 64-bit things, a 64-bit pointer and a 64-bit size T on my 64-bit platform. But to try to optimize this in a way, I could do something like this. And say that I am creating an array of some sort that is my small storage. Now I have the possibility of either small storage or allocated storage. And what is a good use for this is an union. Now I did that episode on safely using unions in C++, and I showed that it is incredibly difficult to correctly use unions. It's incredibly difficult in the case where we have things that are not trivially constructible or trivially destructible. But in this particular case, we do have things that have trivial constructibility and trivial destructibility. So we're just going to now create a union of this storage type. So this thing is guaranteed to never make the size of our string grow. But we do have to add a little bit of extra overhead. And we're going to start this thing by saying it's going to default to small storage. And that's great because it gives us a valid pointer to return C string with without ever having to allocate anything. And we're going to default initialize its size to 0. And we want to default initialize the storage with an object of type small storage that is itself default initialized to a bunch of zeros. Well, so now we need ways to work with this kind of thing. And let's go ahead and create data. And yes, I should be using deducing this instead here. Okay, so I have const and non-const data getters. I really should have done that with deducing this. But I'm not quite sure which compilers support that yet still. Anyhow, this is the basic fundamental way that we are going to take advantage of our small object optimization and our string-like thing. So we have a union that contains the set of either our small object storage or the allocated storage. Now at this exact moment, we can only construct this thing empty and we have no way of ever growing it. So I'm going to go ahead and add two constructors to this just to prove that things work how they should. Okay, so this is the fundamental idea. Two different things that I need to allocate, possibly in access. And let's go ahead and try to use this. And I'm going to write a const eval function. And this is a great way of doing this because if I try to do any undefined behavior or leak at compile time, which const eval is going to force compile time, then I'm going to get a compile time error. Okay, so I just noticed that this constructor doesn't take into account the fact that I do have small storage available to me. And let's go ahead and do that. And I'm going to move away from using the member initializer list because I want the data members to be fully initialized first. It simplifies a couple of things. Okay, so at this point, it should become obvious that this is my first time doing this. It's my second time. I did a practice run of this, but I think you're getting the point here. These are strings that all fit into our small string optimization. If you've been paying attention, there's something that is clearly missing here. So we're going to see it in a moment. When we try to create a string that doesn't fit into our small string storage, I now get a compile time error saying that this is not a constant expression because allocated storage has not been deallocated. Very good. So that means we need to add our destructor. And note, this is a C++ 20 constexpr destructor. And I'm going to get a compile error still, which is also just a great point about how using constexpr can help catch interesting bugs in our code. This is not a constant expression because allocated storage has not been deallocated. If not small storage, okay. All right. So I haven't, I did do the allocation here, so I need to make sure that I set small storage equals to false. Okay. Oh, and then I get this different compile time error, non-array deallocation of an object allocated with array allocation. So I need to make sure I do an array delete here. Okay, and there we go. So we can see that using const expr helped us find several bugs in this code and prove that it executes without undefined behavior and without memory leaks. And this is a very high-level overview as to how one might write a string with small string optimization. And just a few notes, we need to do things like we need to simplify some of the stuff. We need to make some of the code more reusable. We need to add some helper functions. It can greatly simplify the actual implementation of this thing. And I have a little bit better version of this that is also in the notes for this episode. So anyhow, I hope you liked this episode of C++ Weekly. I hope you learned a little bit of a thing. And just to remember that if you're doing this kind of thing, bookkeeping is hard about this, and you need to use const expr to help you test the code. Const expr will actually keep track of, at compile time, which member of the union is the active member, and you will get a hard compile time error if you get any of that wrong. And that's really important because you're not allowed to read from the non-active member of a union, and you really want to be able to catch that kind of thing in your code. Doing this correctly is hard. But using const expr helps you find those bugs and make sure that we have way more tests. Anyhow, thanks again. I'll catch you in the next episode.